Hey, everybody, welcome back. I'm Stephen Warren Hill, your host for Chicago TARDIS 2020, and welcome to the Doctor Who Music Panel. Please don't forget to leave feedback on our panels in the Skedge app. If you lose track of any of our links, always chicagotardis.com. You can find them all there. The Doctor Who Music Panel is something we do every year, basically, and I'm going to introduce you to the panel moderator in just a moment. This year, the panel is going to be taking a deep dive into listening to and then talking about pieces of music, incidental music, from the John Nathan Turner era. And with that, I am going to welcome Robert Warnock to take it away, Rob.
Hello. As Steve mentioned, Nick and I have been doing the music panel at Chicago TARDIS for the past, I want to say maybe 12 years at least, maybe even longer. We've also done an arrangement of the theme for the past, I think, 12 or 13 years. So we do have a special guest, but I will let Nick introduce himself first.
Sure. Hi, everyone. I'm Nick Seidler. I'm one of the people who, along with Rob, composes some of the music that we play at the convention every year and performs with Rob our variation of the theme that we do every year. And we do this panel really to try to highlight one of the more important elements of the series that sometimes gets overlooked. And the music really kind of sets the tone for what's happening on screen in our favorite television program. Even from the very first opening notes of the opening theme music to Doctor Who, it sets the tone for what kind of a show you're going to watch. And so we specifically do this panel every year and then concentrate on a particular era or element of Doctor Who. So that's why we're here, and I'll hand it back to Rob, who can kind of talk about our special event today. So
one thing we're doing a little differently this year is we'll introduce the music first and talk a little bit about it beforehand so you can know what things you should maybe listen for. And as Steve mentioned, we picked music from the JNT era this year. So based on that, I would like to introduce our special guest. I want everyone to welcome Mark Ayers.
Oh, that'll be me. Hello.
Hello.
How are you?
Good. How are you?
Well, going slowly mad in this current state of the world, but as you can see, I have lockdown beard version 3, which is becoming my constant companion.
Probably better than my lockdown self haircut version 3.
At my age, I shouldn't complain about it. Well, there we go. Yes, so we got this list of tracks. Wow.
So Nick is going to play DJ here. We'll just start out. We're kind of going to go in chronological order. So this will focus on radiophonic workshop music and also later music that Mark and also Dominic Glynn worked on, which would have been in the 6th and 7th Doctor eras. So the first track we're going to play is from Megloss, and this is by Peter Howell. Megloss was a little unusual because Patty Kingsland wrote the music for the first episode, and then Peter Howell wrote the music for the remaining episodes, and I think that's because Patty Kingsland became ill, if I remember.
I think it was Peter was ill, actually.
Okay.
And then Peter came back and had to pick up the cliffhanger from where Patty had left it. Yeah. So it's two very different styles of music, but it works, actually. It works.
It does.
Well, I think. Yeah. Because they both have very different styles. I mean, Patty was very much sort of rock and roll with his guitars and his bass guitar. And Peter was very, very heavily into the synths and later very heavily into sampling. But and obviously this was the second story they did after the workshop had taken over, so full time, as it were.
And one thing to listen for in this is it's one of the first times you hear that Doctor Who theme actually turn up as part of the incidental music.
Yeah, I tried that later and was told never do it again. But
here we go.
Great, yeah, Peter Howell, that's mainly the Yamaha CS80, and there's two things in there immediately that stick out to me. One is Peter's use of amplitude modulation on synthesizer sounds to give that lovely sort of vibrato effect. He didn't vibrato, it's more of a staccato type rumble effect. And also the drums actually is modulated white noise. It's not a drum sound at all, it's actually white noise. And then the loudness at the end is by opening the filter so it gets brighter. All very clever stuff. That was Peter for you.
Yeah, it's interesting. I don't know if you can find it anymore, but there was video of him that I saw a while ago talking about how he arranged the theme, and it's 100 times more complicated than you would have ever imagined.
He deliberately made it so. he likes that kind of thing.
You know, Mark, I'm kind of curious. You said that you did yourself put the theme music into it once before. Why do you choose not to do that now? I find it a little bit charming that was done. I'm curious as to your opinion on that.
Sagan started doing it a little bit. I did it once in my first episode, which was Great Show in the Galaxy, as the Doctor and Asa wandering over the hills. The Doctor, I can't remember exactly what happened. The Doctor does something, and I did a little as he looked over the hill. And we were sitting in the dub, and John Nathan turned to me and said, "Don't do that again." I think he wanted very much the music to be its own thing for a story, and didn't want to hark back to the theme. He also didn't want any claims on the incidental music from the John Grainer estate. So there were two reasons why not. But I mean, the reason I did it was that Kef was doing it all the time in his first two stories. So, you know.
Thank you.
So the next clip, if you're familiar with the classic series, you'll recognize this. In fact, when it gets to the end, you'll probably hear the theme start in your head. This is a clip from Legopolis.
We played this live. We've actually played this live. And we did this a bit, of course, with the BBC Orchestra of Wales in the 50th anniversary from Peter and I standing up.
Yes. We actually showed that at one of the music panels a couple years ago, because that I loved that 50th anniversary show they did. But for me, that was the highlight, was you and Peter doing how long was it? About 8 minutes, I think.
8 minutes, 26 years, yeah. Doing 8 minutes.
Yeah, right. So let's listen to that clip now. So.
Oh, once is enough.
Yep. I was trying to get out of there. So
it's lovely, isn't it? I mean, there's a thing about Paddy. Paddy's work is always deceptively simple, but he has this wonderful gift for melody. He also has a fantastic ear, so it's beautifully orchestrated, that piece. There's sort of four or five synthesizer lines and sort of intertwining with one another. He always used to have a bass guitar sitting by the desk to play the bass notes, and a couple of cymbals, so those little swishes and everything as well, alongside the electronics. That is certainly simple, but blooming clever. Very few people have quite as good an ear as Paddy, I think.
And, you know, listening to that, to me, I can hear all the dialogue in my head. I remember recording that on cassette, the actual episode, and I listened to it in the car, you know, for like months on end. And of course, I didn't realize that people had been doing that for years. In fact, we wouldn't have a lot of basically any of that audio from Missing Stories if people hadn't been doing that.
No, absolutely not.
Yeah, I think that clip, especially in the United States, is particularly well known just because most American fans got to know Tom Baker as their first Doctor when the show became popular here. And so I think that particular clip, as American viewers got introduced to regeneration and what that is, that particular clip rings very popular to American viewers. You know, like they kind of associate that with regeneration, sort of like in the modern series, flames shooting out is regeneration. To American fans, that piece of music reflected that. So
it was also, you know, in the UK, obviously, Tom had been the Doctor for 7 years. That was a really big moment in the program's history. Really was. And I think it sort of had a sort of that whole episode with the flashbacks and things had a lot of emotional resonance, I think, resonance for fans at the time. You know. Stay with you.
Okay, so the next clip is from The Visitation, and this is one of the soundtracks that came out fairly recently.
Yeah, a few months ago.
This also was by Patty Kingsland, and this is a little bit unusual because the music sort of sounds of, even though it's all synthesizers, it sounds of the time that the story takes place. But then it sort of switches over because part of it then is in when Nyssa's working on the android in the TARDIS.
Okay, we'll again, play the clip. Oh, yeah. Go ahead, Mark.
No, just say, again, this is Paddy. So, you know, synthesizers were very good and are very good at doing sort of harpsichord type sounds. And so that was ideal for the period. And he used some live drums as well. But anyway, play the clip.
Okay.
Good cue. Again, you see, deceptively simple, harpsichord type sounds and the recorder type sounds, a couple of little drums, and obviously he's got the cymbals again sitting by his desk. So it's just typical Paddy, isn't it? Great.
One of my favorite parts of that composition are almost the very quiet, it's almost an arpeggio that's in the backward that slowly plays and pulses. And I think sometimes when you're watching the TV show, you don't hear all that subtlety, but when you buy the CD and then you have a chance to listen to it, you know, especially with a good set of headphones, it really sounds more full and even more beautiful than when you see it in the show. So,
and the show, remember, it's got the TARDIS drone behind it and all sorts of other things.
Of course, yeah.
And one of the things, Mark, that you had mentioned earlier that I think people kind of forget is synthesizers were originally supposed to be to imitate existing instruments. You know, over time, that's kind of not how people think of them.
Well, it's interesting now, because, yeah, I mean, there's two schools of thought. I mean, the British synthesizer, the EMS, was actually designed not to imitate real instruments, really. It was designed to be a sort of electronic, pure electronic sound, which you then manipulate on tape, which is why it didn't even have a keyboard on it to start with.
Mm-hmm.
The Moog synthesizer was really designed to be a rock and roll instrument. But of course, it was realized that if you were in a rock and roll band and you couldn't afford a brass section, then maybe getting a brass sound out of a Moog synthesizer was not a bad thing. So of course, they all came with patchworks, which said, this is how you make a flute, this is how you make a piano, this is how you make a clarinet. So yeah, they could be done for that. But again, in the BBC, that wasn't talked about very much, because certainly, and this was also the case in the US, but the musicians' unions hated it, because the idea that you get a machine which would make the sound of a trombone player was anathema, because, you know, you should pay a trombone player. And I can absolutely see the argument in that, because, you know, you don't want to put musicians out of business. I think we've got to a point now, you know, where these things sort of quite happily coexist, and we have far bigger worries in the music industry than a synthesizer making the sound of a trombone.
Yeah, and I think things got even worse when people started using sampling.
Absolutely.
More. And, you know, there was that, especially in the 80s, that whole argument about real instruments, and if you were composing music on any kind of electronic instrument, it wasn't quote unquote real.
I think most professional composers are using samplers now, though. You know, if they're using samples, orchestral samples, there are two reasons. One, either because they wouldn't have been able to afford a real orchestra, a live orchestra anyway, or two, because they're mocking up a demo, which will then be replaced with a live orchestra. So,
yeah,
you know, these things find their level, I think.
Absolutely.
And now for something completely different, looking at this.
Yes. So the next clip is from Earthshock, and this is by Malcolm Clark. This is actually one of my favorite scores in the history of the show. I always loved how he wrote these counter melodies and harmonies that didn't go where you expect them to.
It's a bit like Malcolm. He never went where we expected him to go.
I will let viewers know that as we play the following clips, there's not artwork attached to these audio clips. I just want to let people know that. But all of these are from the commercial CDs.
Okay. Very sweet. Malcolm was a maverick. Malcolm wasn't so much a musician. He was really a visual artist. That was his big passion. But he thought of sound in very visual ways. And the reason Malcolm's music sounds so bizarre was he just didn't believe in following rules. And so you're saying about counter melodies and things, he just played it, then he played it again in a different key, and that was the way it worked. You know, it didn't really matter if it didn't, you know, really make much sense. It was the overall effect he was after. And when Malcolm is good, he is very, very good. And I think in that story particularly, he is great. And also in that story, he's using some live drums
and he got to the point, you know, where he got some massive sort of bits of railway line track rail and was hitting them with mallets to get the sort of metallic tones in that story. In later stories, he got the DX7, and of course he decided that that made as good a sound as a bell sound as hitting a real thing, which of course it didn't, unfortunately.
Yeah.
And he started using a lot of sort of DX7 type drums and things as well, which I think wasn't as good as Earthshock when he was actually playing real drums and hitting real railway bits of railway line with a real mallet, you know?
Yeah, there's something about, especially there's that, I think it's like a 3 or 4 note thing that he uses that repeats when you, that lowest note, that metallic note, because it's a sample and it's pitch shifted down and has just this cool, creepy sound to it.
Mm-hmm. Mark, do you yourself like doing the Musique Concrete stuff where you use actual samples of things, or do you prefer to use other, create your own sounds within the synthesizer if you're doing electronic stuff?
The glory of doing what we're doing now is that we have all of those technologies, and I'll do whatever it takes to make the sound I want. And frequently that will start with a recording of a live sound. And it might start with a sound in the synthesizer, or it'll be a live sound and I'll treat it synthetically. I mean, and I do an awful lot of analog production, but an awful lot of digital processing. I think working with analog processing now is an awful lot of hassle, but creating sound using analog techniques, which includes live musicians, they're analog as well, is I think largely the best way to do it. I much prefer real analog synthesizers, I have to say, to plugins. Not to say I haven't got a load of plugins, but to me the unpredictability of a real box of tricks, which can go wrong and frequently does, is an enormous lot of fun.
Thank you for that share.
Okay, so the next clip will bring us to the end of the Fifth Doctor era. This is from Caves of Androzani. This track is called Spectrox, and this was written by Roger Lim. This kind of has a similarity to what we were just talking about. It has this interesting sort of detuned bell patch in it.
Okay, I'm going to start the clip here, so.
Okay.
Yeah, you see again, Roger, when he's good, he's blooming good, isn't he? I think that's my favourite score of his. And that I'm pretty certain is the DX7 synthesizer, the Yamaha DX7 synthesizer, making that bell sound. Okay. This score comes from the same era, of course, when he did the Box of Delights, which is another mega score of his, which, of course, we put out on CD and vinyl a couple of years ago. Well worth listening to. Very similar sound world. The Radiophonic Workshop at this point in its history was sort of really reinventing itself. We'd have been underfunded for an awful lot of time. And Brian Hodgson had come back as organizer and was determined to sort of modernize it. And he got an awful lot of modern synthesizer technology in. And a deal with Yamaha meant there's an awful lot of Yamaha kit came in. And so the studios all had DX7s in, or the TX8 ones, TX816, which is the six Yamaha DX7s in a rack. Oh, okay. A module, no keyboard, just 6 modules. I've got one down there, which is X Radiophonic Workshop. But yeah, all this technology was coming in and being made use of.
And DX7s in that time in the 80s really were everywhere.
Oh, the bell sound, the electric piano sound was all over everything because it was a Fender Rhodes, but better. And a couple of the bass sounds, the fantastic sort of slap bass sound it made. But yeah.
One thing that I think really stands out in the piece that we just heard is the sort of use of drum, like the percussive, you know, almost march-like drums, which sets really a tone for that particular story, which is about gun running, right? So that militaristic, the military trying to stop the gun runners. I really think that addition of that kind of percussive, unexpected sound, you really don't hear too many drums being used to set tone. And I think that kind of march-like sound really sets out in that particular piece. So.
Okay, so the next track then is, this is an excerpt from Vengeance on Veros. If you own any of the CDs, you know that a lot of the stories from around that time were just sort of suites that combined different clips from each of these stories into a longer piece of music. So this was written by Jonathan Gibbs. And for those of you that are familiar with this story, you'll probably recognize what scene this is from.
Here we go.
That's an example of what I was talking about, really. That's very much the TX-816, which is, as I said, eight DX7s in a box, and then you played it with an external keyboard and a sequencer. And Jonathan loved that. And the other composer who never did a Doctor Who, Richard Attree, but Richard Attree did an awful lot of work just using this box, because you could play eight instruments out of just basically one box. The criticism of the DX7, the whole FM synthesis, was that it wasn't very warm sounding, didn't sound as warm as analog synths. But I think Jonathan used to get over that very well. And my favourite stuff of his is the beginning of Marco Lorani, when he did this sort of Vaughan Williams pastoral music, which sounds incredibly warm, which, as I say, considering it comes out of a Yamaha FM synth, is quite extraordinary. But that's how clever Jonathan was.
Yeah, I think there was a people overreacted to that a little bit, and everyone went back to analog for that reason, because it sounds warmer than FM. But like you said earlier, now you can pretty much use anything anywhere you want, and it all works, you know, depending on how you want to use it.
I like some of the keyboard work that's in that piece, where it definitely creates a feeling of being a dreamlike state, you know, like kind of that like repeating pattern that kind of cues you that maybe what's happening is not exactly what's happening. So I think how that's composed, you know, almost is like a lullaby to let you know like what's happening right now is not exactly correct. So
yeah, it's clever stuff.
Yeah.
Okay, so the next clip is another excerpt. This is from Time Lash, and this was written by Elizabeth Parker. And Mark, you can confirm if this is correct. She was actually the last full-time radiophonic.
She was, yeah, when the workshop wasn't she? Yeah, when the workshop was shutting down, eventually there were two composers left. There was Liz, and there was Peter Howell, and they were working on Michael Palin's Full Circle. And they were sort of doing alternate episodes. And the atmosphere there wasn't great because they were, you know, tearing all the studios out. So Peter had a studio at home, so basically went home and completed his work at home. So Liz was still at the workshop. And when I went in there and started cataloguing the tapes, Liz was the only composer still in her room. And she actually was made redundant halfway through working on Full Circle and had to rent her own studio back off the BBC to finish the series. I mean, the whole thing was bizarre. And of course, she's the only woman to have written incidental music for Doctor Who, in fact. I believe I'm right in saying. Because Delia didn't write incidental music.
Yeah, yeah.
Delia did a theme. But yeah, Liz Parker.
And we'll share that clip now, so...
Then, as you could hear, is another case where you just hear the theme pop up for a little bit within the incidental music.
Briefly. It's interesting. You can tell all this stuff. You can tell it's all Radiophonic Workshop, but they're all very different because the composers are different. But they're all using sort of similar gear. Although Liz did have her WaveStation stuff, which she was very keen on, so she has that sort of unique slant. They all have a unique take on it, but you can tell it's Radiophonic Workshop.
And it seems like everyone had their specific instruments they like to use.
What was it? She had the wavetable synth she was using. That was Liz's thing, and Malcolm's thing was, you know, was bells and weird noises, and Paddy's thing was his guitar and cymbals, and you know, Peter liked his CS80, you know, so they all had different things that they majored on.
Mark, you did talk earlier about how you had cataloged the work that the Radiophonic Workshop did. What then happened to all of that work and those recordings and the work that you did?
Well, all those tapes, after I'd labeled, and I put them all in order, I labeled them all, and I built a database of it all because it just didn't really exist. And then it all went off to the BBC archive, and it's all stored at the BBC archive. I still act as a consultant on it because it's still not sort of fully catalogued, because it's not part of the main, the main thing of the BBC library is to obviously archive programmes which can then be sold. Archiving little bits of programmes was all a bit of a, you know, and things which went to make up a programme was not really what the BBC was at. So we sort of slightly sort of bent the rules a bit, but it's all there. So I act as a consultant. They come and ask me what, you know, what's there, and but it's all where it should be, which is at the BBC.
Excellent.
But I mean, obviously I access it all the time because of the Blu-rays and the soundtrack albums and sure. all that kind of stuff.
Well, and I'll let you know that we appreciate that work. We yes, notice it.
Definitely. So. And I think everyone watching probably does too.
Good. Thank you. It's fun to do. And I think it's important work. So,
mm-hmm. So do I. So our next clip is from Trial of a Time Lord, aka Mysterious Planet. This was composed by Dominic Glynn, and this is another thing that people will probably recognize when they hear it.
Here we go.
Certainly came in with a bang, didn't he, Dom?
Yeah.
It's a great cue. And, you know, he'd approached John, like I suppose I did, you know, asking to get us a job. And John was, you know, considering, you know, moving away from using the Radiophonic Workshop all the time, which was a mutual decision because the Radiophonic Workshop found basically it was spending all its time doing Doctor Who and the other things they wanted to do. And Dom had a go, and he made a really nice job of it. I mean, he didn't have anywhere near the amount of gear that the Radiophonic Workshop had. And, you know, he had a DX synthesizer, but it wasn't a DX7, it was a DX21, which was sort of its baby brother. But he made very good use of it, and he came in with Mysterious Planet. And again, you know, that opening model shot with that music, I watched that at Imperial College in the middle of a Doctor Who convention on a big screen. And everyone just went, oh, okay, right, this is different. And it was very exciting.
You know, Mark, you said that you had asked to work on the program, and you've done so much restoration work, and you're a fan of the program. And you just said, I was at a Doctor Who convention when I heard this music. Had you always been a Doctor Who fan? Was when you composed for Doctor Who, was that sort of a dream come true for you?
It was. I have to say, I didn't set out to compose for Doctor Who. I set out to be a composer. And I had always been, I mean, I've been a fan since sort of my early teens, really, when I was watching season nine, you know, Day of the Daleks, etc. And I thought, you know, I love this show. Why do I like it? Oh, I like the way it sounds. So that's something I wanted to do. But I'd got, I was beginning of the 80s, I got a job in television as a sound engineer. I was beginning to do little bits of writing for the BBC, etc. And I went freelance in 1987 and found myself, you know, without an income. That was a bit of a wrench. And so I basically wrote to every producer I'd ever met. One of them, you know, was John. And John, bless him, was the only one who wrote back and said, yeah, come and see me. We'll go. So, you know, I owe John an awful lot. And I'd met John because yes, I was going to Doctor Who conventions. And although in the 80s I was going into Doctor Who conventions, I was watching from the sound booth because I was working on the AV at the convention.
Yep, sure.
So
we understand that, I promise.
So that's what I was doing. I was asked to do Greatest Show, which was brilliant. And then, of course, Curse of Benrick and Ghost Light the following year. And we were told we'd be working on the following season, but there wasn't one. So there you go. Very sad.
And so on that note, the next clip we have is actually from Curse of Benrick.
Ah.
Let's listen to one of Mark's pieces here.
One of the simpler cues in the score, I think. Yeah. I'd love to re-record all that with a big orchestra one of these days. I mean, it was great to do the finale as my sort of 30-second bit of the prom suite, you know, with a big, you know,
yeah.
idea, Ben. But there we go.
That's probably something that, you know, a lot of people would like to do. It's not something that everyone gets a opportunity to do, I would imagine.
Big thrill. Yeah.
We're running out of time here, but we do have one other. We cheated on this last clip because it's not from the show itself. So I have my copy of this was, as you can see, the world's first square CD. So this was variations on a theme. It was four different versions of the Doctor Who theme that you, Dominic Glynn, and Keith McCullough did. And the one that we chose was the mood version. So just real quickly, where do you start when you decide you're going to do an arrangement of the Doctor
Who? I can't remember quite how this came about. I think I'd done what is called the Panopticon 8 thing, which was done as a convention theme, like you guys do, in the 80s. And I think we were all sitting down, it was a 25th anniversary of the programme, and we thought, wouldn't it be fun? Because Kev and Dom had already done it, and I said, I'd love to do a version of the theme. And I think I then said, oh, why don't we all do one, a new one, and put it out as an EP? And that's how it came about. So the other guys went and did one, I went and did another one. I got two tracks down because it was my idea. That was my excuse, and that's how it came about. And I decided to do something sort of terrible, because when the Radiophonic Workshop started, John Nathan Turner had been listening to Oxygen by Jean-Michel Jarre.
Okay.
He took that to the workshop and said, this is the kind of sound I would love for Doctor Who going forward. I want to really modernise it, make it very synthesizery, modern, spacey. That's what I want. And so I tried to basically think, what would Jean-Michel Jarre do if he did the Doctor Who theme? And that's where the mood version came from.
Okay.
If you've got time for 30 seconds of it.
Well, all right. We can let it.
We'll definitely share some of it. So
yes.
Here we go. So much for trying to fade that out clean. So
that was a very subtle fade out. Yeah.
I tried.
Unfortunately, we can't hear further on. I like how you did. There's some cool harmonies that you did further on in that version.
Yeah, well, anyway, it was fun to do, but like everything else that we've been listening to, it was an awful long time ago.
That's true.
I was terribly young and didn't have my third lockdown beard.
Mark, I really wanted to say to you, thank you very much for being a surprise guest here at Chicago TARDIS Virtually Online. Having you come and talk through the music of the Radiophonic Workshop and the Dante era with you is a personal pleasure, and I really want to thank you for that and for being here and surprising our fans and our guests and viewers. So thank you.
Very welcome. Delight to be here.
Yeah, it's always, we can talk as much as we want, but it's not the same as having someone who has firsthand experience talk about this stuff.
And it's not the same as being with you in Chicago, but at least
we're that's true.
Having fun.
Maybe we would love for you to join us, so please come back. So
I hope to do one day, yeah.
Brilliant.
Yeah, echoing Nick's thank you to you, Mark. Thanks so much for taking your time out and to join us. It's been great. And thank you, Rob, for another great Doctor Who music panel. To our audience, our next panel is called Fan Art is High Art. Painter Louis Achenbach is going to do a live painting demonstration to playback of Radiophonic Workshop music.
There you go, yes.
I'm going to hint that, you know, maybe one of the things we've been talking about, possibly doing other virtual events in between live in-person conventions. And, maybe the live painting is something that we're going to try to get off the ground in the future. Maybe
it's a cool idea. It's a very cool idea, I think.
Yeah. So we'll hope for that. In the meantime, that wraps up the Doctor Who music panel. Thank you for joining us for this panel at Chicago TARDIS 2020. And onward, Chicago TARDIS.